Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Plateau United Methodist. On this Sunday after Easter, I'm so glad that you're here, especially any who may be visiting, because we've come together to worship, to praise our living God. So welcome, welcome one and all. I'd like to just call your attention to the announcement, the thinking of you. UMW meets tomorrow. Our senior citizens will meet April the 6th at Ebenezer. Next Sunday is Snack Sunday. The corner table information is there, as is Wesley's Fish Fry. Anyone have any announcements they'd like to share? I saw your hand go up first.
Yeah, I need to work on keep up with thinking of you. Let's do Camilla Shoal this month for April.
Okay. Yes.
Freddy Ford Army Tiger Battalion Rucksack March is scheduled for Saturday, 23rd, April 2016. And what you could just make a pledge while we're doing for running, you can make a pledge or a donation. And if you prefer not to pledge, like, we'll take your donation. We're just running around the track.
Okay. If you have a flyer on that, if you give it to me, I'll see if it goes in the bullet. Anyone else have any announcements?
Good night, Mr. Swim, it's tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night, yes. If not, then it looks like we're ready to worship our living God. Let us stand for the call.
Thank you.
memories of Easter. Let us join in this together. Almighty God, you give us the joy of celebrating our Lord's resurrection. Give us also the joys of life in your service, and bring us at last to the full joy of life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
We move now to a time of prayer. And if you have a joy or a praise you'd like to share, please go right ahead. And sometimes I don't catch these things. So if you want to speak, speak up. Don't be afraid. Anyone have any prayer, praise?
Today is my birthday.
That's a praise. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we serve the living God. For we know that our God lives, and the Holy Spirit that He gives to us dwells in all who will enter, all who will open the door to their hearts and minds and let Him in. Father in heaven, we praise you for all things, the good and the bad. Because we realize during the bad times we grow stronger in our walk with you. We know, Lord, that things happen in life. That we get sick. We get ourselves sometimes in trouble. We find things that we shouldn't, and we go places where we shouldn't. But Lord, we know deep down in all of our hearts, we know that you love us. And that the Son died for us. His precious blood washed all our sins away. And we're so grateful. So thankful that we have you. Dear Lord, you've heard our praises. You've heard our spoken concern. And we all know of people in our lives that need you today. Need your healing touch. Need your comforting presence. Need, O Lord, to have you with us always, which you said that you will. Father, we give everything to you, our thoughts, our prayers, and ourselves. Father, we just ask that you bless each and every one that's here today. bless those that are not here for whatever the reasons. We're thankful for those that traveled this past week, returned home safely, and we're praying for those that are still away from home. Father, we pray for everyone in uniform. We pray, oh God, that you'll watch over them and protect them from all harm. We ask, oh Lord, this and so much more. We pray for our church, our denomination, that it will be strengthened, be prosperous, and fulfill the vision that you gave to the church. Father, there's so many things that we can ask. But Lord, search our hearts and our minds, for we ask this in the name of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. a musical talent. If our children come forward, we'll have our children's time.
Good morning. Good morning. My story this morning is comes from Matthew chapter 13, verse 23, and the scripture says, "But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it." And one of the reasons I picked this piece of scripture is because soil is pretty important to me and what I do. You have to have good soil to grow good plants, don't you? But have any of you ever planted anything? Ever planted any seed? Planted a garden? Yeah. I got a couple packets of seed here, so we'll pass them around and let you look at those. And but good soil is really important to the success of a garden. And if the ground's too hard, if it's full of rocks and weeds, it won't grow good plants. And in our Bible lesson today, Jesus told a story about a man, and it's called the parable of the sower. But the story is not really about so much about the sower, but it's actually about the soul, more about the soul than the seed. And some of the seeds that fell on the path where the ground was very hard. And the seed sprang up quickly, but when the sun came out, the plants dried up because they didn't have good roots. And some of the seeds were planted on rocky ground, and I brought a rock with me, and I want you to look at that and hold it. Now, do you think when you get this, if you put seeds on top of that rock, would they sprout and grow? What do you think? No. That rock would be just like a plate for the birds to come eat the seed off of it. So, and then some of the seeds fell among the weeds, and if you plant seeds among weeds, well, the weeds are probably going to take over the seeds you planted, and they're going to just choke those seeds out, and it won't produce a good crop. But in Jesus' story, the Word of God is the seed. We are the soil. And often when we come to church, Pastor David's preaching the Word, but we're really not listening very good, very well, or paying attention. And maybe we're thinking about what we're going to do after church, and maybe we're thinking about what we're going to have for lunch after church, and our mind's not really here. And that's like throwing seed on top of the ground. It won't ever grow into anything in our life. And there are other times we hear the word and we get excited about it, but our excitement fades away and we drift away. And that's like the seeds that fall on the rocky ground. The plants spring up, but then they die because the roots are too shallow. And sometimes we hear the word and we believe what it says, but we want to still keep on doing the same things we keep on doing. It's not always good things. And that's like planting the seed in a bunch of weeds. And you know the weeds are going to take over eventually. So when we hear the word and we listen to try to understand what it says and put it into practice in our daily life, we are like the good soil. We are like soil that where the seed takes root and it grows and it produces a plentiful harvest. And that's the kind of soil that Jesus wants us to be. And what kind of soil are we? Let us pray. Dear Jesus, we want to be like the good soul. Help us to listen to God's word and put it into practice in our daily life. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Rick. Thank you, children. If our usher will come forward, we'll have a word of honor.
Then the same day evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut,
where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus, and stood in the midst and said unto them, Peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then Jesus said to them again, Peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so I send you. And when he said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins you remit, they are removed unto them. And whosoever sins you retain, they are retained. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, We have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, Except I shall see in his hand the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the door being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, Peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. Thomas answered and said unto him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, and yet have believed. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Hands. You ever think about your hands? You ever hold them up, look at them like first grade teachers? Well, in New York anyway, walk in and say, Let me see your hands. Then she looks, Oh, good, you didn't clean them. Think about hands for a few minutes. One of the things that sets apart ourselves from the rest of the animal kingdom is we have an opposable thumb. We can move it. We can grip things with it. Cats, dogs. The monkeys come the closest. They're having the same hand that you and I have. Hands, though, are important. We need them. We depend on them. We take them for granted. But in the scriptures, hands are mentioned over 1,800 times. They're in all the both New and Old Testaments, and they're there, everywhere. Quintilian, a first century Roman master of rhetoric and public speaking, he said, the hands are different from all else. And I wrote it down so that I wouldn't forget. He said, other parts of the body assist the speaker, but the hands speak for themselves. We all know people that if you tied their hands together, they couldn't talk. Because every time they talk, they make a guess. But think about the hands of Jesus. Doubting Thomas, bless his heart, he made one statement, I don't believe until I see. Forever after, through all of history, he's known as Doubting Thomas. Remember, Jesus arose. People don't do that. So Thomas had reason to doubt. But when he made his statement, and of course Jesus hears everything, when he came back 8 days later, he said, Here, look at the nail prints. Stick your hand in my side. Think about the hands of Christ for a moment. Would they be smooth? Would they be gentle? Jesus' hands would probably have been rough. Because after all, he was brought up to be a carpenter. And carpenters in the first century, we think of carpenters today, and we think of hammers and nails and wood. The first century carpenter was a jack of all trades. He might be dealing with a broken harness or a piece of leather one second, and then finishing the cabinet the next. Carpenters led hard lives. They worked with their hands. They, like hands today, they cut, they were cut, they were bruised, they were broke, just like hands today. But think about Jesus' hands. He was brought up as a carpenter, they would have been rough. No doubt about it. But look at the hands of the Christ from the inside. These are hands filled with love. These were hands that could raise the dead, could calm the storm. These are the hands with one touch could make the blind see, the lame walk, the dead come out of the tomb. The hands of Christ are extended to all the world for all time. The hands of Christ are given to you and to me. Jesus' hands, even though now they're scarred even more, they're filled with love. They're filled with hope. They're filled with joy and peace. They're filled with comfort. You know how comforting it is when we're having a bad day and someone just lays a hand on your shoulder and says, it's going to be all right. Think of the hands of the Christ when his hands are laid on our shoulders. And he whispers in our ears, don't worry, my child. I am here. It's going to be all right. Thomas, he had to see Jesus. He had to not only see Jesus, but he had to see the holes, the scars, before he believed. Even though his disciples told him, even though Jesus himself said time after time what was going to happen, Thomas didn't believe it. I will not believe until I see it. What did Jesus do? First thing he said is peace be unto you. Peace. These are the hands of peace. But then he singled out Thomas and he said, here, look. Look at the nail holes. Put your hand in them. Stick your hand in the hole in my side. There's a painting on the wall in a place called Carter's Barbecue in High Point, North Carolina. This is a huge painting. It's right when you come in and you stand in line to order, to counter. It shows a little girl's crying. But it shows the Christ with his hands reaching out to her. The artist put the hole in Christ's wrist. We can see the gash in his side. There's such an expression on the face of the Christ that just warms your heart. The little girl is looking up, and you can just see the beginnings of a smile as she gazes into the Savior's eyes. Hands. The hands of Christ are reaching out to you and to me this morning. The hands of Christ want nothing better than to be laid on us, on our shoulders, or maybe the small of our back, keeping us on the right path, still teaching us and helping us in all that we do. I guess if there was one word that described the hands of Christ, some say callous, some might say smooth, some might have another description. But I think that the hands of Christ say love. I love you, my child. These holes in me were put there on account of you. On account of everyone in the world from all time. Jesus said, blessed are those who have not seen and believe. That was Christ's blessing for you and for me. Because obviously, we haven't run across the Christ body yet. But someday we'll see him. And then maybe he'll show us his hands and his feet and his side. But until that day, the hand of Christ on earth. Our hands. We are the hands of Christ on the earth because of the Christ lives in us through the Spirit, that He's working through us. In our hands, we may not have the power to heal or raise the dead, but we can lay a hand on someone's shoulder when they're having a bad day. We can lay our hand in the small of someone's back when they're starting to stray off the narrow path. It's our hands that are Christ's representative in the world today. Just one day, try this little simple prayer in the morning. Lord, use my hands to help someone today. But if you say that prayer, be careful. Because 9 times out of 10, our Lord will say, okay. Okay. But He might want us to take our hand to some place we don't want to go. He might want us to lay our hand on someone's shoulder that we don't want to get near. So if you say that prayer, be careful. Be careful. But if you say it, you will be rewarded. Christ's hands are your hands and my hands in the world today. Hands. We don't take them for granted. We shouldn't. Because we don't know. And just in a fraction of a second, we can lose them. I have an uncle that was a master loom mechanic, Cannon Mills in Canapolis. When he works on a loom, these things are so big, a lot of times you can't see them if you have to get underneath them. The operators put up a red flag. My uncle was underneath one, working on it. The foreman came by, the floor walker, and asked the operator why she wasn't working. She said, well, there's a red flag. He said, I know you put that flag up sometimes just to goof off. And he took the flag down and pushed the start button himself. My uncle had his hand up in it, adjusting gears when the loom started up. The only thing holding his hand in his body was just a little 16th of an inch of flesh that was between the gear's teeth. He suffered a long time with that hand before he finally died. And he said it once, he said it 100 times. Don't take your hands for granted. Let me see your hands. Well, I don't want to see them, but look at them. Look at them. No, they're the hands of Christ on earth. Don't take them for granted. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. First Sunday of the month is Holy Communion. I invite you to turn with me to page 15. Not leaving it. For the great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
This is the Sunday after Easter. The Easter day itself is still very much in our minds. We worship a living God whose tomb is empty. And so with your people on earth, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and joy by the unique hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We know the story of the upper room. How after the meal, he took up a loaf of bread and broke it. He blessed it. And he handed it to them, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which will be broken for you. Then he picked up a cup that hadn't been used. He filled it full of wine. He blessed it. He gave it to them. And he said, here, take and drink. For this represents my blood, which I will soon shed for you. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts of Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, communion with Christ, offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Our gift from the Lord is the Holy Spirit. So we ask the Holy Spirit to come down and bless these elements before us, making them be for us the body and the blood symbolically of our Lord Jesus Christ. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. If our communion steward will come forward and we'll begin serving the meal. Know this, Jesus died for you. With that thought in mind, go in peace to let others be followed. Thank you. families. You have found peace and comfort in the knowledge that your sins have been forgiven through the body and the blood of the Lamb. Go in peace to others to become. Amen. Say communion. Your freedom has been bought by Christ. It was bought by a terrible price, paid for us so we wouldn't have to. Know this, God loves you. God cares for you. God has forgiven you. Take that knowledge and depart in peace. We have communed together as a family of God. Soon we will leave this place and go out into the world. But know this, we don't go into the world alone. For wherever we go, the Christ is with us. No matter where we go, we're never left alone. But we have to do our part. We have to open the door to our heart and our mind and let Him in. Communion reminds us of that. I hope that all of us feel better having come to the altar and communed together. Our closing hymn is number 3086 on the screen.
Yeah.
We serve a living God. We worship a living God, which says, go in peace, filled with the Father's love, the Son's grace, and the Spirit's comfort. Go now in peace, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.